President Trump resorting to fear-mongering and falsehoods to turn out the Republican vote in the midterms just 2 weeks from today. The president is focusing some of his biggest lies on this caravan of thousands of desperate migrants who are working their way north. The president is insisting, without a shred of evidence or facts, that there are dangerous people embedded among the migrants.
As the caravan, and look, that is an assault on our country. That's an assault. And in that caravan, you have some very bad people. You have some very bad people. And we can't let that happen to our country.
His claims are getting stranger by the day. The strategy seems designed to scare voters by constantly repeating a false threat. But the president's not stopping there. He claims to know specifically what kind of dangerous people are traveling with the migrants.
You're going to find MS-13, you're going to find Middle Eastern, you're going to find everything. And guess what? We're not allowing them in our country.
All right, that was the president. I'm standing in a completely different place now, and his pitch is coming into focus with early voting beginning today in more than 20 states. Tomorrow, the president hits the campaign trail again. He goes to Wisconsin there, a state he was very proud of winning in the 2016 race. Today, the biggest names from both parties fanning out across the country to back their party's candidates. Former Vice President Joe Biden, Senators Bernie Sanders, Kamala Harris are the headliners for the Democrats, focusing on Florida, Arizona, and Iowa. House Speaker Paul Ryan also in Iowa for the Republicans.
Okay, so let's bring in CNN senior White House correspondent Jeff Zeleny, Republican strategist and CNN political commentator Kevin Madden, and the former director of communications outreach for Hillary Clinton's campaign, and our newest CNN political commentator, Jess McIntosh. Jess, great to have you here.
I'm back here, by the way. I just want to know how quickly I came back here.
How did you do that?
I'm in a lot of places.
That was hyperspace. Okay, Jess, great to have you. So something strange is going on with the president. He's making more and more outlandish, really unhinged claims. I understand fear-mongering. I get it.
Right.
But don't they have to generally have a germ of truth to make them believable to voters?
Usually, yes, although Trump's base seems caught in a particularly insidious, inclusive bubble where he can perpetuate lies and they just don't go unchallenged. They go unchallenged because all they do is listen to the same sources that are repeating the president's lies. What's really interesting is that this close to a midterm election, they are simply unable to talk about any of the issues that voters are actually interested in voting on. They have no plan for health care. We have seen them fail to replace Obamacare with anything for years now. Their tax plan backfired hugely. There's no plan to increase wages, jobs. These are the things that people are actually going to turn out for, and Republicans simply can't campaign on them.
Well, look, I think the Republicans have a different message there. What I'm interested in, Kevin, is why the president thinks this is effective. Because clearly, this has been planned. And a lot of it was going on last week while people were focused on Khashoggi. If you turn on Fox News, they were talking about the caravan. They were talking about immigration. Why is he saying these things? And why spread some of the lies?
Well, look, I think the president, if you look at the footage from yesterday's rally down in Houston and then you compare it to 2016, when the president gets out on the campaign trail, this is one of these issues are the ones that he's most comfortable talking about, because I think for him, they help draw the contrast between his opponents and also remind his base voters about what's at stake. And what I would disagree with, Jess, is, you know, immigration is an issue that everybody's always talking about. I think there are very clear differences on that issue. And in the 2 weeks right before the election, when you're trying to juice your base, you do tend to talk about and focus on the differences and the contrast that you have with other parties. So it is right now, if you look again, the president is just making a very direct, simple appeal to the base voters he believes are important to helping Republicans win in November.
Jess, just to rebut that, how do you know people don't vote on immigration? Maybe that will drive people to the polls.
Immigration is certainly going to drive the Trump base to the polls. That is certainly a motivating factor for them. It is not a motivating factor. And I would like to separate the idea of immigration as an issue and lying about a caravan full of people. That is actually nothing to do with our overall substantive immigration policy. But he's absolutely right. That's going to help Trump drive out that base that gets really riled up by the fear-mongering and the racism.
Jeff Zeleny, our intrepid White House reporter who was at the rally in Houston, and I pressing the White House for all sorts of things. I'm sure they provided you with a comprehensive list of the Middle Easterners who are part of this caravan. Yes?
Well, in the words of the White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders, she said there absolutely is evidence of Middle Easterners being in those caravans. Asked to provide such evidence, no answer. So the reality here is there is no specific evidence, as far as we know, or we certainly think they would provide that. But the reality here is I was in Houston. I was at that rally yesterday, a giant rally by all accounts. Was it 100,000 people who RSVP'd, as the president said? No, it was not. The Houston police chief said there were 3,000 people outside and 18,000 inside. That is a big rally. That is a bigger rally than virtually anyone else could draw. And that here is the issue for Democrats. This is a message the president is carrying. He is nationalizing these midterm elections, which usually isn't how it works. Usually midterm elections are much more local affairs. And it's one of the reasons we're seeing sort of, you know, a divergence of views here. Yes, so many voters are looking for pocketbook issues, but the president clearly sensing that that wasn't firing up his base enough, so is talking about this. And I can tell you, inside the arenas, inside the rallies, it works without question. The bigger unknown question here is we'll find out in 14 days, what effect is it having on independent voters in swing states, other places where he isn't going? Outside the rallies, this could be having a much different effect. But I can tell you, Democrats are much more worried about the outcome of the election than they have been at any other point of this year here. So the president knows what he's doing. He's firing up his base.
Jess, he just said you're scared, are you?
Oh, yes, of course. The stakes are very, very, very high.
Not just the stakes, but are the signs pointing to trouble?
No, I mean, the signs are pointing to Democrats having a good night. I say that with all of the caution and the optimism that I can. I'm taking absolutely nothing for granted, and I don't think anybody in my party is. I think the big question is, what does the electorate look like? We are seeing some insane numbers coming out of early voting. In Georgia, the first day of early voting, it was up 300%. The first day of early voting in Houston drew crowds of 2,000. We have simply never seen numbers like this, which means that we may not be looking at an election that is made up of Trump's base and the progressive base. It might be made of a lot more Americans than usually turn out, which I think would be a wonderful thing.
Really fascinating. That's really interesting context. Yeah, Kevin?
No, and that has to be the concern for many Republicans, because while Trump's rhetoric may play with base voters, one of the big worries that you have to have is that one of the demographics that's going to factor very large in many of these battleground districts for the House, which are in suburbs, are going to be suburban women. And suburban women don't have the same reaction as base voters do when you have very divisive rhetoric on things like immigration. So this could be counterproductive for a lot of those Republicans in places like in the suburbs of places where I am right now, like Chicago or, you know, places like outside of Philadelphia, where there are a lot of battleground races that are going to decide whether or not Republicans are able to keep the House.
Kevin's absolutely right. In fact, talking about immigration to those suburban college-educated women, they think about the family separation. They think about the kids who are still being detained. That is the opposite of a motivator for them. So he might be sacrificing what was pretty typical, a Republican voting bloc, white women. He might be sacrificing them to play up that base.
Jeff, explain one more time. I understand that fear is a motivator, but why can't the president run on the economy? Why can't he run on the unemployment rate having gone down? I mean, his accomplishments. Why has he rejected that so outright?
It's a great question. And the president does, of course, you know, he's still talking about the economy, but it's in a very different way. The reality is about a month or so ago, I was told by a couple people who speak to the president all the time about this. They say he was resigned to essentially losing the House. Republicans were going to lose the House. He and others wanted to flip the script here and fire up the Republican base. So he is essentially reverting to what he did in 2016 because it worked. He believes all of these things work. Yes, there's record unemployment. You know, there's certainly so many things to talk about, but why is he talking about a new tax cut at this point? He promised last night here in Houston a 10% middle-class tax cut right before the election. That's not happening, of course, we know, but one of the reasons he's talking about it now, because he hasn't been really selling the tax cut plan from last year. He hasn't been talking about this as much. So with all of the, you know, sort of a noise in the air and chaos in the air, nothing is breaking through like immigration does. So that is one of the things here at the end of the day. And the White House and the president is willing to sacrifice, you know, some of those seats perhaps in swing districts for the greater good. And they have the blessing of geography here. Look at that Senate map. It's almost impossible now for Democrats to win control of the Senate. That was not the situation just a few weeks ago here. So look for him to go to red states, red areas, but he's not going to a lot of the places that he won in 2016. This is a base election, and it's a fair election, and there's not really much of a response on the Democratic side. Yes, Barack Obama was out yesterday. Joe Biden was out, but it's no one who has the megaphone of Donald Trump.